me just give you his tribute to Nelson Rolihlahla Mandela.
I now present to you the great leader who has been in jail for 27 years, who has done everything for your freedom. I therefore present Nelson Mandela to you.
Hundreds of millions of people around the world are mourning. How did a political prisoner of 27 years, classified as a terrorist, not only by the apartheid state, but by all Western powers, how did he become so loved? The question is, what does Nelson Mandela personify, and what does he stand for, which makes him tower above all others? We're exceptionally lucky that we have been sent a contribution. He sent in a written speech, and you'll just have to imagine that I'm crazy. I look quite that crazy, don't I? And he's from the Marxist Workers' School of South Africa. He is a former member of ANC and an important one as well.
Comrade Kwesi Kadali from South Africa. He is a veteran of the anti-apartheid struggle. At the time of the Soweto uprisings, our comrade was arrested and put behind bars and tortured, I think, for 4 months. Subsequently has played a long role in the African National Congress, the ANC, spent some time in Britain in exile, and, as well as other countries. And now the comrade is engaged in building a Marxist workers' school in the East Rand, and really pursuing the next step of the liberation struggle.
Dear comrades and friends, I would like to thank the Communist Party of Great Britain, Marxist-Leninists, for the opportunity to address this gathering.
So let me just give you his tribute to Nelson Rolihlahla Mandela, the first democratic elected president of the Republic of South Africa, revolutionary and freedom fighter, commander-in-chief of Umkhonto Wesizwe, political prisoner, statesman, and beloved father of the nation, died on the 5th of December 2013. South Africa is in mourning. Africa mourns. And indeed, hundreds of millions of people around the world are mourning. How did a political prisoner of 27 years, classified as a terrorist, not only by the apartheid state, but by all the Western powers, how did he become so loved that a young woman in Brooklyn, New Jersey, when interviewed on TV, remarked, "Mandela is the only state president who will be missed." The question is, what does Nelson Mandela personify, and what does he stand for, which makes him tower above all others? To understand who Mandela was, we need to go back deep into the dark days of apartheid, when the National Party came to power. Within the ANC, a conservative leadership had taken control, which had no strategy to counter the offensive of white capital and its national party state structure. Within the ANC Youth League, a new and more radical leadership formed itself around Walter Sisulu, Nelson Mandela, and Robert Sobukwe. They were inspired by the anti-colonial struggle taking grip of Africa. They were inspired by the anti-imperialist struggles throughout the Third World. They reached out to the progressive white community, and they recognized the Indian and colored communities in South Africa as part of the oppressed, and they formed an alliance with these representative organizations in a common struggle for freedom and democracy. Most importantly, instead of debating the plight of our oppressed people in small circles, they went to the masses. They organized the masses around concrete issues of educational, living conditions, and political issues. Through effective mobilization, they not only frustrated some of the repressive measures of the apartheid system, but eventually they took over the leadership of the ANC itself. The movement grew to become such a formidable force that the apartheid government was unable to control and submerge the movement. They resorted to mass killings like the Sharpeville massacre. The response of the people was to redouble their efforts of resistance and mass protest. The regime then responded by banning the ANC, PAC, and other political parties. All political activities, public gatherings, and demonstrations were banned. Nelson Mandela, together with Walter Sisulu, Ahmed Kathrada, Governor Mbeki, Raymond Mlaba, Andrew Mlangeni, Billy Nair, Dennis Goldberg, Rusty Bernstein, and others, took the historical decision to go underground, continue the political struggle of the ANC, and form a military wing of the movement called Umkhonto Wesizwe, the Spear of the Nation, in order to confront reactionary and fascist state violence with revolutionary people's violence, and the armed struggle was born. It is this historical and principled decision, in a situation in which all doors are closed for peaceful protest, to call for mass mobilization and an armed struggle in order to defeat the enemy, which made Mandela a true leader. He became the first commander-in-chief of Umkhonto Wesizwe. After his arrest, the CIA was instrumental in that Mandela and nine other ANC leaders were put on trial. Like Comrade Georgi Dimitrov, who was put on trial by the German fascist state, who used his trial to expose fascism to the whole world, Mandela too, during his trial, exposed the racist nature of the apartheid system in front of the whole world and defended democratic principles and non-racialism, ending with a famous statement, "During my lifetime, I have dedicated myself to the struggle of the African people. I've fought against white domination, and I've fought against black domination. I have cherished the ideal of a democratic and free society in which all persons live together in harmony and with equal opportunities. It is an ideal which I hope to live for and to achieve, but if needs be, it is an ideal for which I am prepared to die." This statement reflected the aspirations of millions of oppressed black working men and women throughout South Africa. His refusal to bow under pressure, torture, and repression was a reflection of the steadfastness of our people. Mandela was one with our people. He was sentenced to life imprisonment with hard labor. He went on to break stones together with other political prisoners under the hot African sun from dawn to dusk for many, many years to come. The apartheid state, in their cruel nature, would take those stones from Robben Island and build numerous monuments, courthouses, and other symbols of their tyrannical rule and for the glory of the apartheid system. Mandela not once complained. Instead, he was in the forefront, organizing the struggle within the prison camp for better conditions, medical care for prisoners, the right to read newspapers and books, and the right of political prisoners to study. Above all, he spearheaded the struggle behind bars from the very first day for political prisoners to be treated with dignity. As a result, a number of political prisoners in the 70s and 80s left Robben Island highly educated. By 1994, many were ready to take up positions in the newly formed Democratic South Africa. 1984-85, the struggle intensified. The underground structures of the ANC, the labor movement, and the United Democratic Front developed into a mass movement, and South Africa became ungovernable. The apartheid state approached Mandela and offered him and all other imprisoned leaders to walk out of prison on the condition that they renounce the armed struggle. This strategy, most certainly under the advice of the US and British advisors, was intended to divide the ANC into an exiled ANC and internal ANC and set one fraction against the other. Mandela issued a statement confirming his unconditional support for the armed struggle and reaffirmed that there's only one ANC and one ANC leadership under the leadership of Oliver Tambo. He stated that he will only walk out of prison without any conditions attached or he'll not walk out at all. The apartheid strategy to divide the ANC collapsed. It was this principled stand which earned him the respect of the entire movement. 4 years later, Oliver Tambo had just suffered a stroke and all political prisoners were released. Nelson Mandela emerged from prison as the unquestionable leader of the ANC and the entire democratic mass movement against apartheid. During the Kempton Park negotiations, he emerged even before being inaugurated as the first democratic elected president of South Africa, as a statesman towering over the last apartheid president to such an extent that at the end of the negotiations, de Klerk was reduced to an ordinary member at the negotiations table. Mandela had exposed de Klerk as a man without integrity in full view of the entire nation when he caught de Klerk backstabbing and double dealing. Just before the 94 elections, the ANC security found out that de Klerk and a number of army officers in South African Defence Force were planning a military coup d'etat. Mandela understood that the South African Defence Force was still loyal to the arch-racist P.W. Botha, the apartheid president before de Klerk. He travelled directly to P.W. Botha's residence, and during an extremely heated encounter in which Mandela insisted that P.W. Botha called off the coup d'etat, he threatened Botha that if the coup went ahead, he would call up for an all-out armed resistance. Botha backed down, called off the coup d'etat, and Mandela avoided perhaps one of the most brutal and barbaric civil wars of the 20th century. This moment was the end of de Klerk's political life, and Mandela will be remembered for generations to come as the leader who rose up to the occasion, avoiding bloodshed and genocide, and ushering in the first democratic government in the history of our country. Mandela was able to talk with authority, threaten P.W. Botha, and stand his ground, because the entire resistance movement stood as one man behind him. determined and disciplined. No sooner had Nelson Mandela been inaugurated as the state president, the imperialist countries, especially the United States, mounted pressure on him to distance himself from socialist Cuba and its leader, Comrade Fidel Castro, to distance himself from Libya and Muammar Gaddafi, and to distance himself from supporting the national liberation struggle of the Palestinian people and the chairman of the PLO, Yasser Arafat. Nelson Mandela stood firm and held his ground. He declared that Cuba and Libya, Fidel and Gaddafi, had supported the anti-apartheid struggle throughout our dark years. There's a bond of friendship between our people, born out of a common struggle. We will not betray our friends. On the issue of Palestine, he declared that the struggle of the Palestinian people for national liberation against Zionism is a just struggle. We will stand shoulder to shoulder with the Palestinian people and their just struggle. Ultimately, imperialism had to give up its pressure. Every confrontation with Mandela exposed the reactionary role and intentions of imperialism. Intellectually, the occupants of the White House, as well as Downing Street, were no match for Mandela and his integrity. In the build-up of the US invasion of Iraq, Mandela openly confronted the United States, exposed their bloodthirsty and inhuman plans, and condemned their invasion as a crime against humanity. When Obama, in his typical Sunday speeches at the FNB Stadium, declared that Mandela has taught him to be a better man, well, perhaps he should, as Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces of the United States of America, start by stopping the endless slaughter of men, women, and children in Pakistan, Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria, Libya, and Somalia. Perhaps he should start by ending the torture and sodomizing of political prisoners and dismantle secret prisons and close the Guantanamo concentration camp. Perhaps he should start by removing his armed forces from close to 100 countries around the world and behave like a civilized country among civilized countries. Perhaps he should start by ending the barbaric economic boycott of 60 years against socialist Cuba and the Democratic Republic of Korea, two countries which pose absolutely no threat to the United States. Perhaps he should start by destroying the biggest arsenal of nuclear, biological, and chemical weapons in the world, namely the weapons of mass destruction of the United States. US imperialism has inflicted mass murder and genocide, war crimes, and barbaric military invasions against the people of Korea, Vietnam, Cambodia, Lebanon, Somalia, Iraq, Libya, and Syria. It has installed brutal military juntas in Latin America, Africa, and Asia in the past 50 years. George Bush, Bill Clinton, Hillary Clinton, and Barack Obama have nothing in common with Mandela, the revolutionary, with Mandela, the statesman, and with Mandela, the man who has put his life more than once on the line to avoid bloodshed and civil war. The heads of all Western imperialist countries were present at Mandela's funeral, not that they share any of his noble values, but all of them are in desperate need to be seen to be close to Mandela, the only president admired and respected across all the populations of the imperialist countries. Especially the Iraq invasion, justified on the basis of weapons of mass destruction, which turned out to be a complete fabrication. The introduction of the no-fly zone in Libya, justified in order to save peaceful demonstrators. 24 hours later, the US and NATO forces started terror bombing raids, paving the way for counter-revolution to destroy all social, political, and economic achievements of the Libyan revolution since the overthrow of feudalism, and inflicting terror and genocide against black Libyans. They organized and coordinated the barbaric slaughter of the head of the Libyan revolution, Muammar Gaddafi, and thousands of other Libyan revolutionaries. The past 2 years, the world has witnessed how US, British, and French imperialism organized and financed the counter-revolution in Syria, slaughter of hundreds of thousands of people. The destruction of the entire state has become the order of the day. Millions of ordinary people around the world, including in the imperialist countries themselves, are aware of the crimes committed in the name of freedom and democracy. The leaders of the so-called free world have been exposed as war criminals, as oppressors, and the imperialist warmongers. And in order to save at least a bit of their damaged image, and driven by sheer desperation as their war crimes are catching up with them, they huddle around Mandela's body, mumbling sentences of forgiveness and becoming a better person. Mandela will not exonerate them of their crimes, and the victims will never forget nor forgive them. Progressive and revolutionary forces around the world should expose imperialist leaders as opportunist liars and charlatans. They have nothing in common with Mandela, and we should make sure that they will never succeed to drive a wedge between Mandela and the anti-colonial, anti-apartheid and anti-imperialist struggles of our people in South Africa, Africa and indeed worldwide. The desperate efforts of our exploiters and oppressors to define who Mandela is, what he stood for, and what values he represents. These efforts through cinema, TV, radio, and print are nothing but cultural imperialism at its worst. In its quest to colonize our minds, weaken our resolve, split the anti-imperialist struggles of Africa, and open the gates for a full-scale economic and military recolonization of Africa. Needless to say, all their reactionary plans will finally fail. Africa will not be recolonized by US and EU imperialism. Long live the revolutionary spirit of Nelson Rolihlahla Mandela. Let Mandela's revolutionary life, his discipline, commitment, his loyalty to the oppressed be an inspiration to future generations of liberation fighters. Our long walk to freedom will continue until oppression and exploitation, war and hunger, ignorance and poverty are a thing of the past. To this end, let us celebrate the life of Nelson Mandela, defend his revolutionary legacy in the light of distortions and lies, and intensify the struggle against imperialism. There is no better way we can honour this outstanding son of the African soil. Long live Nelson Rolihlahla Mandela.